We need it today, God. Hallelujah. Somebody look at their neighbor and said, I'm living in the overflow.
Fresh anointing is flowing by.
final say so. Hallelujah. God has the final say so. Hallelujah. If we thank you, God, we thank you for having in control. We thank you, God. Hallelujah. We thank you for making the way when you thought there was no way. We thank you and we reverence you. We know that you're great. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God. Bless your name, Jesus.
How great! Thank you. fullness for your presence. For your presence, God. God, I thank you. Hallelujah, God.
Still, God is trying to purge some things out of us today. Hallelujah.
So the things that we came in with, that we're ashamed of, or that we want to hide, we can leave it here. He wants to, we're going to sit in this moment. He wants all of us, even the dirty parts, even the parts we try to hide. He wants it all. You don't have to be ashamed. You don't have to be scared. He's going to love you anyway. He wants to purge some of these things out of us so that we can leave it here and leave healed and better. Hallelujah. So we're lingering in this moment. Hallelujah. We're lingering in this moment because he wants to break some things off of us. Hallelujah. And heal some things in us. And sometimes you got to destroy to rebuild. Hallelujah. Sometimes you gotta be broken to be built better. Hallelujah.
If we all this way you need us, take me there. Take me there. What you need is just an offering. I'm right here. My life is here. And I'll be a living sacrifice for you. You're the fire, the fire. I wanna be consumed. I wanna be tried by the fire. Purified, you take whatever you do. Is my life. I wanna be tried by the fire. Purified, you take whatever you desire. For is my life.
Feel this. burn me holy, burn me beautiful, burn me lovely, burn me righteous, burn me holy, burn me beautiful, burn me lovely, burn me righteous, burn me holy, burn me beautiful, burn me lovely, burn me righteous, burn me holy, burn me beautiful, burn me lovely, burn me righteous, burn me holy, burn me beautiful, burn me lovely, burn me righteous, burn me holy, burn me beautiful, burn me lovely, burn me righteous, burn me holy, burn me beautiful, burn me lovely, burn me righteous, burn me holy, burn me beautiful, burn me lovely, burn me righteous, burn me holy, burn me beautiful, burn me lovely, burn me righteous, burn me holy, burn me beautiful, burn me lovely, burn me righteous, burn me holy, burn me beautiful, burn me lovely, burn me righteous, burn me holy, burn me beautiful, burn me lovely, burn me righteous, burn me holy, burn me beautiful, burn me lovely, burn me righteous, burn me holy, burn me beautiful, burn me lovely, burn me righteous, burn me holy, burn me beautiful, burn me lovely, burn me righteous, burn me holy, burn me beautiful, burn me lovely, burn me righteous, burn me holy, burn me beautiful, burn me lovely, burn me righteous.
Peace of God which transcends all understanding. Amen. Listen. It's my birthday this week. I'm turning 32. You know what I'm saying? Long 32 years. Long. 35 in some books. You know what I mean? But listen. What I'm praying for this year is peace in my life, in my household, in my church family, on my job. Everywhere I go, I want to be surrounded by peace. Amen? Because I want to tell y'all something I learned. I don't know a lot, but I know some things. And I know one thing You can't pay for peace. It don't got a price tag on it. You can have a million, 2 million, it don't matter. Peace. 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 People search the world looking for it. People lose everything looking for it. Because the opposite of peace is confusion. The opposite of peace is trauma and hurt and pain. And people will do anything to escape it. When I was up here last week, what happened, and Pastor called me this week, and I thought about it after she called me. I said, you know what? I said, the reason I love my church and my leaders, and some stuff you can't pay for. You know what I mean? I could go sit in any church and on the back row and, you know, and just go every Sunday and say hi and bye and maybe never get noticed. But what I was going through last week, and when she called me up here and prayed, and that peace that came over me this week, there's nothing I could do. There's nothing I could do for that. It ain't a price tag. It ain't a tithe. It ain't an offering. Amen. There's nothing I can give for that peace. Because when you don't take care of that peace, I got friends, I don't want to say a lot, but I got friends that don't walk with God, that don't go to church, and they kind of believe, but they don't really believe, and you know, it's the fake belief. And the fake belief will leave you confused. And there's no order, there's nothing, you know, they just living life. You live in life and nothing's easy for you, everything, every week is another problem. Because you live in confusion, and you don't have no order. And 1 week, some things is good, and the next week they're not good. And today this is okay, but tomorrow is not okay. Because I look around, and it's only confusion that can lead to some of this stuff that's going on in the world. You know what I mean? Because, listen, all of us make mistakes. The difference is, some of us bring it to God and we correct it. And some of us decide to live in it. And you turn a mistake into a lifestyle, and next thing you know, you feel like you're stuck and you don't have no choice. That's a big part of that spirit of suicide. It's confusion. It's confusion. And you don't bring it to God, and you sit in it, and you just sit in it and sit in it, and you feel like the only way out is to end it. But we rebuke that spirit, amen? We rebuke that spirit of confusion. We rebuke the trauma. We rebuke anything that's not peace. That's all we want is peace, amen? And I know it's not easy. I know some of us, it's hard to submit. It's hard to do this and that. But trust me, we all going through it. It ain't easy for nobody. So if you're struggling to come to church or struggling to do your part, whatever it is, no, it's not easy for none of us. Some of us just choose to submit to it. Because what other choice do we have? We tried everything else, it didn't work. Amen? So as we prepare our tithes and offerings, if you're watching online, sgnlb.org, we're going to sow into this ministry today. But what we're sowing for, we're sowing for peace. We're going to sow for peace that transcends understanding. Amen? Because if we don't have understanding, we don't have nothing. I'm starting to figure that out with my own kids and my own life. We got to get some understanding around here. You know what I'm saying? Because if we don't, we're going to end up on the news. Beating one of these kids up. I'm going to do y'all like my mama used to do me. Amen. So at this time, if we can stand, if you're in the house, let's bring our seeds forward. My seed makes me boss. My seed makes me boss. Thank you. God, thank you for all that gave, those that wanted to give, those that had a heart to give, those that gave even when it wasn't easy for them today, Lord. We're asking that you bless this tithe and bless this offering, and that you provide peace, peace that money can't buy. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Amen. Listen.
Blessings and glory.
I feel like we got some people in here that can sing that we don't know about. You know what I'm saying? It's your chance. It's your chance. Mario.
Thank you, Jesus.
Gary. Hey, anybody, this your chance, Kurt. You won. This your chance. Don't say it. Nobody ever let me see. Hey, Deacon Andrew, Slap. He can sing for real. Y'all, he can sing. Come on, Slap. Understanding, yes sir. That's the next revelation. You know what I mean? I ain't prayed enough yet. Almost. It's coming. Yeah, it's coming. God ain't gonna let me be able to sing. I never sit down. I never write a message. I just get up here and sing every time. Let that carry you. You know what I mean? Some of them. But without further ado, we can stand to our feet. We can stand to our feet. We're going to honor the leaders, the angels, the pastors, overseers, overlookers, the ones that God sent for us. Amen. We're going to bring them up right now. If you could, put your hands together. Give a big praise. Pastor Nick and Carol Simpson. Amen.
Just We could have stayed on. Amen. Everybody was caught up. Amen. Amen. Happy birthday, we social justice pastor. Amen. How many of you run around here like your son run around here? One thing different, he ain't touching women's boobies if they get their offering. God has brought me a mighty long way. Amen.
me and Sister Bowen and Sister Simpson back at the time, we were ministers when I was a minister. And she was too. And somebody went up behind us and said, Sister Bowen, your son is touching every woman's butt when they come through the aisle for the offering. So we laid back in the cut. And we watched it. Every person went through me, boom. And you know, that was the right butt too. They were coming through. And the skirts on. Everybody. And he knew where to land.
Mario said he's playing for.
Trying to bring him out. We laughed that day. I mean, he didn't want to touch him at two. He went, boom. And they said, who touched him? David Boyd. Yeah,
he was back about that tall.
Yeah.
Man, we thought he was going to be a midget then for me.
We'd be carrying him around at five. Put that boy down.
We probably rode free on the plane till he was about 10.
We did get you to be places for free.
Don't open your mouth if they ask you how old you are. How old are you? Seven? Amen. All right, we're going to jump on this work. But I know what you're talking about, man. And boy, if I could sing, like Pastor Dewey, somebody had a voice like that.
Let it out.
No, God won't be pleased. No. I'm better than I was, but I'm still bad. I'll never forget one time, it's probably almost 30 years ago, we was at a church at a baptism, and I was just singing my little heart out, right? Just singing. Pastor Sherry was standing next to me. I'll never forget, after church, she said, boy, you can't sing it all. Maybe you just need that lip sync or something. Don't let nothing come out your mouth. I was like, dang. So I started practicing. I'm like, I got a little better. You know, I can always sing with you. I've been singing for 42 years.
Singing
every guy in my pocket.
He was singing on Wednesday. He was singing on Wednesday. Payday.
What day was you singing?
Oh, don't care, my baby. Unless you got some more money. We will not have a discussion.
Let's get into the word, please. Amen. I'm coming to you this morning from the English Standard Version Bible. From John, the 14th chapter, the 6th verse. John, the 14th chapter, the 6th verse. Don't try not to be before you long. I know everybody wants to get back to the cool comfort of their own home. Amen. Thank God the air conditioning working in this place. Amen. John, the 14th chapter, the 6th verse said, Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. That the title of my message today, it would be called Choices. Choices. How many of you know we all have choices in life? Amen? Some of us make the right choices. That's good. Me. Some of us make bad choices. God knows I've made some bad choices in my life. But thank God my good choices outweigh my bad choices. Amen? Amen. In the realm of life's uncertainty and ever-changing paths, a famous man once shared a profound insight that is worth re-exploring today. He said, we can't predict
how things will work out in the future. We can only understand how things fit together when we look back on our past. I know I look back on some things, some choices I made in my life, some good choices I made early on in my life to not go down certain paths. You know, I was one of those kids that was, I was bad, but I knew how far to go. And because I was kind of scared, you know, mainly from my daddy. Yeah, y'all have done know my daddy. My daddy looked crazy. You know, he used to tell me all the time, say, son, I'll kill you, I'll bury you, and you know I'll get away with it because of who I am. And I really believe that. I was probably grown before I was like, he couldn't kill me. He killed me, but I don't think he could have got away with it. I don't know. He may have, but he had a lot of friends in high places. Maybe like Trump and Ben, you know. Like Trump said, I killed somebody on Fifth Avenue, and nothing happened to him. And that's the kind of way he walked. So I knew. I wasn't worried about the police. I was worried about my daddy, you know, finding out. So when I get ready to step over that line, I say, I got a choice to make right here. Finally, I got to the point where my friends would say, look, we can't go do this, this, and this. You can't go with us. I'm like, how come? They said, because your daddy not only going to kill you, he's going to kill us. So we go, you got to go. You can't hang out with us tonight. And I look back sometimes and I laugh now and I say, thank God, God had his hand on my life back then and I didn't go down a certain path. And I know it wasn't nothing but God, because God knew which way he wanted my life to go. But God gave me those opportunities to still, you know, the path was there, the fork was in the road. I could have went to the left, I could have went to the right. Thank God I chose the majority of the time to take the right path, amen. And even in deciding whether when I was getting out of the military, we were thinking about staying in California, and we seriously thought about it. I was being recruited by the LA County Sheriff's, and so I was thinking about, you know, moving further south in California and maybe becoming going on the LA County Sheriff's. And I think, what if I had chosen that path? That was not the path for me, you know? And I had choices to make. And when it came time to make a choice, I said, no, I'm going back to Las Vegas. And even when I came back to Las Vegas, I had plenty of job opportunities when I got back here. And I chose one that everybody said, you kind of crazy choosing that one, man. You're going to be forever before you can retire. You know, you don't give up. You got a chance for some PERS jobs with the city and the county and, you know, Southwest Gas. Why do you want to go work way out there? And I thought I could just go do it for a couple, I thought I'd do it for a couple of years and then I'll do something else. And who would have known 33 years later I'd still be there. And I'll stay another 33 years if they'll have me. You know, and I'm one of the ones that I love my job. I wake up every morning and I'm like, yes, it's a work day. My wife, I'm telling you, she had to beat me over the head, you know. I purposely took my laptop and my Surface computer into work 3 weeks ago to get updated. And from my work office at home, and I purposely, when I brought it home after being updated, I purposely had it re-plugged and back up into the monitors and stuff to try to prevent myself from working every weekend. Because if I see the computer, I'm just going to say, well, let me just go home and check something. Next thing I know, it's 4, 5, 6 hours later. So what I've been doing is I've been getting up on Fridays when I wake up naturally on Friday and I go into the office for a few hours. And I can go in the office for 3 hours and get like 6 or 7 hours worth of work done because ain't nobody there. Maybe a couple of other senior people may be there, but ain't nobody coming and talking to me. My phone ain't ringing. There's no meeting to go to or anything like that. So you're trying to use wisdom and say, you know, you can't work 7 days a week or a week and be in good, how am I say be in good health? She said, and be married. Well, then every other Tuesday night at midnight, you won't hear bing. Are you still taking my money? See, choices. We all have choices. I choose not to work 7 days a week. But stay in God's good graces and hers. But this man also suggested we should trust that all our experiences will somehow lead us to good things in the end. Here is the original quote. You can't connect the dots looking forward. You can only connect them looking backwards. So you have to trust that the dots will somehow connect in your future. You have to trust in something, your gut, destiny, life, people that don't know God call it karma or whatever. This approach has never let me down and has made all the differences in my life. But I will add in, we must also trust God to connect those dots in our life. Our life goes from dot to dot to dot to dot to dot to dot. And when our life ends, that final dot connects. And then what lies there is a map of our life, on how our life was. We have hiccups along the way because sometimes we make bad choices. But as long as we make it to that next dot, we can keep going forth. With this astute observation, he brought us back to a fundamental truth about the unpredictability of our journey. As we negotiate, as we navigate the twists and turns of life, we often find ourselves unsure of how to navigate the moment, challenged by ambiguity, and compelled to make decisions with no clear roadmap ahead. However, in these moments of doubt, he calls us to a place of our trust in something greater than ourselves. Here are some of the useful lessons you can take away. Trust your intuition, or just trust God. Hindsight leads to better choices. See, we want to sometimes trust others, or we want to look at the path that others have taken to get to a certain place. But maybe God is calling you to go down a different path. Amen. God ain't called for all. Let me give you an example. So this week, this past week, I was invited to a meeting. The meeting had been planned for a couple of weeks. I didn't know if I was going to be invited. It was a very high-level meeting with senior directors and directors and people like that. And I helped put a presentation together for a couple of the directors that I was working for, and one of the directors told me, said, "Look, I've asked permission to have you invited to this meeting. You and somebody else, one another senior person from my staff." Eventually, the invite came. So I got into the room, and I'm somebody that observes, right? So we were invited to. It was two whole day sessions, but we were only invited to the afternoon session on the first day and the morning session on the second day. And then the rest was just the directors and the senior director and one of the VPs from the company. But I sat in the room and I looked at everybody in the room. And I actually looked everybody up in the room, right? I went to LinkedIn, right? And I looked everybody up in the room that I didn't know their background. And I'm looking and saying, what path and what roadmap did they take that got them in this room? And I looked at all of them, right? And I looked, and I could not find anybody in the room that took the same roadmap that got me in the room. One came close, but it was still a different room. And I looked in the room and I said, okay, there's four women in here. One of them is a director and level three on. Two steps below a director. And then I looked and there were no other minorities in the room but me. And I said, wow, this is kind of strange. And then I thought about the roadmap. And I said, God, if I had made this choice some years ago, it wouldn't have put me on the proper roadmap to get me in that room. Well, it's the same way in your life. In the same way, especially in your spiritual life. Sometimes we can make detours on our walk with God early on, and it throws us off the path that God wanted to put us on. And it's not saying that God can't get us back on the path, but sometimes we have a lot of heartache before we get to that path and get to going right. So sometimes we can get from point A to point B a lot quicker and not have to take those detours if we make the right choices. And that's why we got to keep our ears open to hear what God is saying to us. That's why I tell people, when you go into your prayer closet, if you are talking more than you are listening, you've missed the whole point of prayer. Because prayer is not a one-way conversation. It's a two-way conversation between you and God. You can pray for stuff all you want, but if you don't never shut up, how you gonna hear when God is speaking back to you and telling you how to get it? Amen? Listen. We all know or believe we know the path that God has laid before us. My question to you is, how many of you are willing to sacrifice something to stay on that path? Sometimes we may have to sacrifice the choice that we think may make us feel good and choose the choice that may make things a little painful for us. See, we don't never like to be uncomfortable. We want the easiest way to the end of the road. Amen? You know, none of us want to go through anything. But the problem is, over half the stuff we go through is self-inflicted because of the choices we make. Over half the things we go through is because we made wrong choices back here. And if you make a wrong choice back here, you will have a difficult time getting to this ultimate finish line where God wants you to get. Amen? Amen. So, you know what? I can keep going on and on and on with this, but I know Pastor Carol got some real good stuff, and I want to give you some time to jump on it. So we're going to turn this over to her. Amen? Amen.
I'm glad you made it your choice. And that's for real. Come on, give God a praise, Pastor Nick. Amen? Hallelujah. Choices. When I heard God say that, he said, oh my God, that's a good subject. Choices. Choices. We all make choices, sometimes good and sometimes bad. Amen? God led me over to Samuel. With Saul, First Samuel chapter 15, amen? Really that whole chapter. But God told Saul in the first chapter, he said, Samuel also said to Saul, the Lord sent me to anoint thee to be king over his people, over Israel. Now therefore hearken thou unto the voice of the words of the Lord. I'm going to skip down to where he says, verse 3, he said, now go and smite Amalek, and utterly destroy all that they have, and spare them not, but slay both man and woman, infant and suckling, ox and sheep, camel and ass. But Saul and the people spare Agag, and the best of the sheep, and of the oxen, and of the fatlings, and the lambs, and all that was good, and would not utterly destroy them, but everything that was vile and refuse that they destroy utterly. God bless the word in Jesus' name. So we see here Saul decided and made a decision and a choice. He was not going to obey God. And it wasn't just because of his greed, it was because of his choice. And a lot of times we make choices in the midst of a situation where God has given us instructions, given us directives. But we make choice because what's presented before us. Sometimes we're in a crowd of people and it doesn't seem popular not to go the way they're going. So we make a choice. Amen? So he made that choice. I'm going to take Agag, I'm going to take some of the good stuff. Surely God don't want me to throw this gold out. You don't want me. Let's save this. Amen? But I know one thing about God, because he knows what's in our future. If he tells you to do something, he means to do it, just like he gave us the directions to do it. And that's how when we make choices and get off on the wrong path, that we end up dealing with the wrong people. Amen? Then we end up in the wrong situations. How many have been there? We've all made bad choices, amen? And it's led us down a lane and an avenue and a path for a season. And sometimes those seasons can last quite a long time. I've been there. Connected with the wrong people, making one choice. I remember Pastor Nick used to tell me some things, and I said, well, he probably just don't see. And I made wrong choices, not listening. We have to be attentive to voices that God sent in our life. And I know this, every voice does not have to be popular. We waited, it was Bishop T.D. Jakes, we fall all out. Come on, Bishop, as a simple person, we go, okay, if they tell us something that we don't want to hear, we don't want to listen. And the Bible says this, woe when all men speak well of thee. Everyone's not going to speak well of it, and how you know you got the right voice talking to you is because that voice is going to have a balance in your life. They're not going to always be petting you up and giving you good things, amen? And that's when we get off at and make the wrong choice. I'm running away because I don't like what they're saying to me. Now, the person's character is correct. I've seen that within myself and with other people. And I tell you, I don't care if it's a dog barking, if God's trying to talk to me, I want to hear it, amen? Because making the wrong choice can last a decade, sometimes two or three decades, depending how you will let God process you with that choice, amen? And any type of not paying attention, come on now, can cause you to be disobedient. You got people talking over here. You got people talking over there. And it seems like, don't you know, God said this to me this morning. He said, don't you know the devil can bless you just to make you make the wrong decision and the wrong choice? He will do that and have you on the wrong path for a decade until you look around and go, wait a minute, this ain't panning out right. That's how you know you made the wrong choice. Amen? But he kept moving. And this is what Saul did. He kept moving in under the anointing that he thought he had. But God lifted the anointing off of him because he was disobedient with the choice. Don't you know a lot of times people are running on wrong paths. And we think they're so anointed that God's word is going to go out and it will not return void. But all the time God has lifted his anointing off of them. And then they begin to run as a Saul. And that turns into witchcraft. I've seen people do that. And I said, no, their anointing is lifted up off of them because they were disobedient. We must be careful in this season with the choices that we make. It's imperative. Amen? If you don't know what choice to make, it's best just not to make a decision or a choice at all. It's best just to lay back and sit still. Amen? So you can see clearly. But Saul refused to repent. You know what makes us do things and not repent? the spirit of pride. Said, well, just be nice over it. Just act like they really didn't do it. And just move on forward. Don't you know, when you move forward in those type of spirits, that's pride. Amen? My mama used to say, and I know I say it all the time, Carol, did you do it? I say, yeah. I don't have time to go, let's resolve, let's get to the bottom of the problem. I did it, let me own it. And then let me go ahead and get the funds or whatever I need, amen? To move forward, amen? And solve the problem, amen? Sometimes we stay in problems long because we do not admit what our part was. We don't own it. We just skip over it. And I'm big on this. It's just easy to say, you know, I'm sorry. And move on, amen? Let that thing out of your spirit. Don't pretend that you didn't say it, you didn't do it, you didn't act it. Just, I'm sorry. And move on. You have to even name the things you were sorry for because you probably did 5 or 6 things. Come on. And move forward. Amen? You have to own what happens when you make a decision, when you make a choice. The Bible says the anointing destroys the yoke. That's another way why you'll realize that the anointing is lifted off of an individual. Because if the anointing is not destroying the yoke that's on you and that's on people around you, there's no anointing. Sometimes we're just doing things and making choice. Let's have this occasion. Let's do that. Pastor Nick said something one day. He said, if there's no purpose in it, why are you doing it? We have to consider that. Amen? Choices will cause separation from people. Because sometimes you'll make a choice that's right, and they'll want to stay making choices that's wrong. Then they'll have to be separated from you. Because if you make a choice to stay with them, you make a choice to be destroyed. Choices will cause enemies you didn't know you had. Galatians 4 and 16. I am therefore become your enemy because I tell you the truth. Lord God, I made a lot of enemies in my life. Not because I wasn't likable or lovable, because I told the truth. And they said, she always saying something. Uh-huh. You know why? Because if you do not tell people the truth, sometimes people will make the wrong choice. Even when you tell them the truth, they will still make the wrong choice. Amen? And you'll still be blamed somehow. Choices to obey will cause you to be blessed. It will cause you to be peaceful. Don't you know, I remember on my job, and I've making choices to hang out with people that were somewhat saved. Are you listening to me? And God told me, he said, didn't I tell you to go to your car and have your lunch and go by yourself? Well, because they made a choice to take me to Olive Garden or Red Lobster, I want to be with them. Huh? And look at this. Making that choice, God told me, he says, who is your brother and your sister but those who do the will of the Father? This lady didn't do the will of the Father, but she knew God. Did you catch that? She did not do the will of the Father, but she knew God. So I decided, made a decision, a choice. I hook on in with her. She's one of my brokers. I prophesied to her about her book of business. She came into business in her late 50s. And went to college and high MBA. I said, listen, God showed me that you're going to get a book of business and you're going to be equal to those that have been here a long time. Don't you know God will place you and exalt you and elevate you into a level that you are on your with your peers. They've been there a long time. But God will elevate you. He don't do that as favor. Put favor on you. So guess what? One of the brokers left, and when you leave, you don't just take your book of business. You do all you can to transfer your clients. But they gave that whole book over to her, and it was a good book. So she got good clients from it. So she was happy and bumpy. I remember this girl. I couldn't get into now, but anywho, it was a wool skirt she got it from Express. And she got this lint. I couldn't fit the top. I shouldn't even get the top away. It was like a silk top, long sleeve. I mean, it was sharp. A long necklace with a pearl to match it, pearl earrings. I was styling and profiling on Sundays with that outfit. Oh, yes, ma'am. Get into it. So I'm getting caught up in my choices. Because looking, oh, she's so good to me and taking me to Olive Garden and wearing lobster and having me come over her house. Look at the choice. Not discerning what's before me. God sent the woman of God, a prophet, to say, be careful, woman of God, on your job. People, that's not your friend. Right? And out of the book of Malachi, and I said, huh. Still making a choice. Instead of backing up and looking, don't you know when you're not amongst a situation so close, you can see? You can see people. Amen? So lo and behold, the general manager, the assistant general manager, they cahoots together for no reason, but I know it was the enemy, but God used it as a part of my process. Got together and demoted me, and she had a voice in it. Now, I've been working with her, helping her, and when I was at the receptionist desk, taking over for her, answering the phone for her hour lunch, I get phone calls from good clients. Well, you know, I want a broker, pass the call over to her, just to be a blessing, because I could put them wherever I want. And she would always get that person as a client, and they had good money to invest. Well, she lied and said, I was not doing my job correctly. Called me in and said, you know, I'm sorry. I lied. God made her tell the truth. Baby, I could have broke out in a preach and a slap up in that office. I wanted to get, like my sister said, not G-H-E, not ghetto, but ghetto, G-E-T-T-O. I wanted to get right ghetto, but I kept my composure, my character. I said, now why would you lie on me? God has blessed me, used me in your family, with your children, with you as in business. Well, because they came and asked me, did you know what you do in your job? And because others said that you weren't, I said the same thing. And let me tell you, the majority don't rule, the truth does. She made a choice to lie on me that day. Baby, I got in my car, I cried like a baby. Because I trusted in her to do the right thing. I made a choice. But God had warned me about my choice. As time went on, I left that job and God blessed me with another. Guess what? She called me. She said she had not been smoking for 20 years. She said, can I please take you to lunch? I said, yes, I made a choice. I got in the car. She said, I'm not going to smoke. I can't believe it. I hadn't been smoking in 20 years. And I just started smoking again. She was nervous and shaking. I just want to apologize again to you, Carol, for what I did. But because she made a choice. But I repented to the Lord like Saul didn't do. The Bible says in Revelation, repent from which thou hast fallen. Come on now. Least I put your candlestick out. And a lot of times, repentance will open the door back up for you for a second chance in your decisions, in your choices that you have made to lock you into situations, lock you into relationships, lock you into jobs, and lock you into a certain mindset. Repentance will cause the chains to be broken and destroyed and open up the floodgates and bless you and come on now and get you through and turn things around for you. When you take that posture, yes, sometimes it's embarrassing and humiliating because you trusted God. You believe God. You made the right choice. I went out to lunch with her. I talked to her. I said, you out of line for what you had done to me. She could have cost me my livelihood over a choice. Being with the majority. But let me tell you something. Y'all know I'm preaching. I got to get a copy of it from somebody who got this book. Amen. I gave them. God, I wrote it in the magazine. God knocked the hell out of me. God knocked the hell out of her. I have to say one thing, that I was still kind to her for the choice she made. But that repentance opened up a door for her to get it right. And she did no longer have the book of business that she had. Making a choice. What choice will you make today? Number one, choose Jesus. Choose him to be at the front of your life. Choice. good choices, choices to obey will cause God to bless you. And it'll cause you to be peaceful. Don't you know things will be raging and warring all around you, but God will do what his word says. He will give you peace that surpasses all understanding. You won't even understand why you got peace with chaos going all around you if you obey. Don't be like Saul. Tell God, I'm sorry, Lord, I made the wrong decision. That's why this is happening. That's why that is happening. It's okay. We all make bad decisions. I've done it before. And let me tell you something. Some decisions will lock you up for 20 years. You hear what I'm saying to you. 30 years. It will lock you up. But if you throw your hands up and say, God, I'm sorry. God, I know I heard you. I kind of felt an inkling in my spirit, but I made the choice anyway. God will free your spirit. He'll free your mind. He'll free you up. Amen? But the good news is like Samson. He made bad choices as well. But what did he do? When he came to the end of himself, sometimes people take 30 years to come to the end of themselves, and they can really stand underneath that pressure and know it's not God. Samson apologized. Said, God, forgive me. Because he knew better. He had been trained well by his parents. He knew his lineage, his heritage, his culture. But he still let Delilah get up to him and find out his secret to his anointing. And when he repented, he did lose his eyesight. Because sometimes you lose things in the choice. Come on, just put your hands in the air and say hallelujah. Sometimes you lose things in the choice. But what's so good about it, he didn't lose everything. He lost his eyesight, but when he repented, God blessed him and returned his anointing on him to kill more Israelites, amen, than he had ever killed. God let him be strong and do exploits. Amen? God restored him greater after he repented. Amen? He restored him greater. God told me this, and I'm almost done, Pastor. That when we realize that we're wrong, and we repent, and we own it, and we fix it, God said that's honor in the earth. That's honor. And then you can live to tell about it and tell people, let me tell you how I was an idiot. Amen? Make wise choices this season. Consider the cost and the sacrifices. Because at the end of the day, Saul fell on his own sword. You can mess up your whole life, the whole legacy of who you are, making wrong choices. God wants to free some people today from wrong choices and decisions. And people, let them walk away. God must be able to trust you this season. He's going to lead and guide us by his spirit this season. Listen to him. Obey him. So you don't end up in a bad situation for a decade or two decades dealing with the wrong people. I don't care if you've known them for 20 years. It doesn't mean that's the choice God has for you in this season. God told me we are all products. We are all products of our own choices. That's why we can't blame other people. Because God gives us opportunity to make the right choices. Come on, stand to your feet. Hallelujah. Choices. Choices. Come on, stretch your arms out. This weather will make you lethargic, amen? It really will. Choices. Come on, give a little stretch on that. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Just stretch those arms out. Hallelujah. Stretch those arms out. Come on. Glory to God. Choices. Choices. Repentance will get you through and turn those things around. Yes, it will. I'm telling you, even in your mind, because that's where it starts first, in the mind, amen? In the mind, God will free us, amen? Hallelujah. Come on, just wave those hands in his presence. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come here, EP Phyllis, before I want to get in trouble by God. Come on, stand here. Minister Deborah, I want you to come over here. And Ashley, and A.P. Sherry, and Angeline, stand behind her. Behind her. Hallelujah. I want you to stand in front of her. And I want you, Minister Deborah, I want you to lay hands on her for strength, for encouragement. I see you. We got to restore you. Hallelujah. Come on, Pastor. We're strengthening you. As you walk this path, it was on me very strong this morning. God says, surround her, put your hand in her chest. Hallelujah. Strength, encouragement. Hallelujah. You made a choice. You said, God, I'm going to still walk with you. I'm going to still obey you. Though he slay me, I'm going to trust in him. Be strengthened. Be encouraged. Come on, pray. Come on. Come on, we ask y'all to help us pray out there. Come on, put your hands this way and say, encourage the executive pastor. Encourage EP. Strengthen her. Has God break you from within? My devotion. You on the end. My God. God, how much can I take, Jesus? Do they know and understand? God, help me, Jesus. He said he's a very present help in the time of trouble. Woo. My God. My God. Hallelujah. The prayers of the righteous availeth much. My, 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 my. My, 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 my. Hallelujah. My, 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 my. Hallelujah. 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 Joy return. Peace return. Strength return. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. No weapon formed against you shall prosper. No weapon. From this day forward, God, that he will fight for you. Woo. My God. My God. In the name of Jesus. We cover you. We pray for you. In the name of Jesus. Oh, Shakidana. Kedeniosia. In the name of Jesus. We'll be strengthened. Be encouraged. You will make it. Yes, you will. You will. You will not faint. Hallelujah. You will stand. In the name of Jesus. Ooh, my Jesus. Hey God, echo fiata. No weapon formed against you, it shall not prosper. We strengthen your hands to war today. We strengthen your mouth to praise today. We strengthen your heart. Ha. Forgiveness. They know not what they do. God is going to work it out for you. He's going to deliver you. My. Not many days hence. Oh, my God. It will happen. Ha! Destroy every yoke, God, in the name of Jesus. Woo! My God.
oppression. Who shot Katuka? No oppression here, Katuka. Run down, take it out. Never. Hey, in the name of Jesus. You're going to make it through. You're going to make it through. Release it right now. Release it. Release it. Be free. Be free. Strengthen from the crown of your head to the sole of your feet. Hey, God. Be strengthened. My God. We cover you. The blood of Jesus. Oh, my God. In the name of Jesus. Woo! My. Glory to God. Put on the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. Praise him. Lift up your voice like a trumpet and praise him. Hey, he's still good. He's still good. He's still good. God said, I'm still good. He said, lift your voice up and praise me. Praise your way out this time. Back in. God says, never give up. Don't give up. Praise your way through. There's light at the end of the tunnel. Stand. 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 Stand, says God. Stand. Stand. And watch me work. Stand and watch me work. Stand and watch me work. I'm working even now, said God. Hey. God said, it is me that avenges you and subdues your enemy under you. My God, just praise him and watch me work, said God. Praise me and watch me work. You've been strength for everyone else, man. We're strength for you. We're here for you. We love you. You are more than a conqueror through Christ Jesus. Oh, yes. You are victorious. You are victorious. You are victorious. There it is. There it is. There it is. Ow! Give him that war cry. Ow! In the name of Jesus. Glory to God. Glory to God. There it is. There it is. Pusha. Precious in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. There it is. Release. 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 Release it. Release. My God. I need.